And where I was going to start, you point at the screen, but the computer is there, with this symbol. This is the symbol of the Computer Society. And it is, what I'd like to do is start with it and ask basically four questions. What is it? What does it mean, actually? What does the Computer Society actually do? How do we support innovation, which is one of the important things we're trying to do today? And in particular, what can the Computer Society do for you, for your organization, for your job, for your career? Let's start with the who. We are a private, global, nonprofit professional society. Those are a lot of words, but what they basically mean is that we are an organization of people who are involved in the same kind of things and want to support each other and support the body of knowledge. What is it that we actually do? That was something I had been asked all along, and the quick answer is that we organize and validate information. We publish things, we hold conferences, we create standards, we try to understand where the trends of technology are going. But in all of these things, we are working to organize information. So where do we get to the innovation side? Innovation is, of course, looking at the world anew, taking our knowledge of technology and science and engineering and using that to see something new in the world, to provide a new product, a new service, a new company, a new way of handling problems. And we support that by supporting the people who do the innovation, the high-tech workforce. And what's the purpose of this for you? I have given this talk all around the world. Just 3 weeks ago, I was giving something very similar in China. I've given it in India. I gave it last May in Kazakhstan. What it does is it makes you as an organization and as an individual a stronger global player because you have connections not only with your neighbors and not only with your friends, but people who are doing similar tasks around the world. The picture up there is a picture of the Computer Society's main office, which is in Southern California. It's in a small town called Los Alamitos. If all you had were the technical people in Los Alamitos, you wouldn't get much done because most of them work in that building. But we provide connections with technical people around the world and help you build that community, which is truly global. All right, who are we? We are, and this is of the IEEE, we're a professional society with about 400,000 members. Half of them are outside of North America, and it's organized in two ways. We divide up the IEEE two ways. We organize it by sector: computing, communications, power, system, signal processing. All of these are divisions of the Computer Society. But we also divide it locally, by chapters, by regions, by groups. There's a Moscow chapter and a Russian section, and it's part of the European division, Division 8 of the IEEE. And we get them together from time to time. The picture up there is a meeting of students that occurred in the United States, of student leaders from around the world. And we had them to get together to ask, what are you doing with your career? Where are you going? What are your needs? And how can we help you best? We have been around since 1888. We were founded as an American institution in 1888 to deal with electrification, with building networks of power lines across the world. We moved from electrical power into electronics in 1914, which is just as we have developed amplifiers, radio tubes, and because of that, we now have a new set of problems that we need to understand. We got involved in computer hardware in 1938, and the picture there is the picture of Howard Aiken. Howard Aiken was part of a division of the IEEE that was then called the Institute of Radio Engineers. He had a problem involving how you deal with electronic tubes, the devices that were used for amplifiers in 1938. He did not know how to solve it in closed mathematical form, which is what we always like, but never happens in the real world. And so he decided he would build a machine to compute the answer, to compute how electrons flowed around and past barriers inside the tube. The result of that calculation is the machine, which he's inspecting part of, called the Mark I, which he built at Harvard University. But that is one of the very first computing machines that started in 38 and 39, and by the late 1940s becomes a wave of computing machines that has continued to grow. We became involved in software roughly in 1968. And the Computer Society Division, of which I was president, begins roughly then to deal with the problems of software. Because we got this idea, which was new at the time, that the problems of software were not the same as the problems of hardware. That it required new concepts, new ways of organizing things, and in particular, new ways of engineering. This has been one of the great things of my life as Computer Society president, because by training, I'm a mathematician. I have a doctorate in applied mathematics. I did mathematics because my father was a very early computer engineer, and so when I got to college, there was nothing for me to study because my father had taught it all to me. And so I started working this field from the point of view of a mathematician, of what are the models that we deal with. When I got to be a professional, I began to realize that many of the professional societies assumed you knew electronics, which I know a little bit, roughly equivalent to my knowledge of Russian. But the professional societies of 1968 and 1969, and of that era, believed that electronics was how you understood computers, that if you did not understand circuit theory, you would never understand them. And most people who deal with computers now have no idea of what the circuit is, of how the electronics works. They take it on faith, and they build their innovations out of software. We became involved in global cellular telephony about 1990, and some of the very early innovations in cellular telephony come from our members as they're trying to understand, how do you make mobile devices work? What do you need? What kind of bandwidth? What kind of computing power? From this point, what ties it all together is how we organize knowledge, because that's what a professional society does. A professional society, I like to say, is a circle. It's a very big circle that goes around you. Inside the circles are professionals who are building and defending knowledge. Outside of the circle is the public. And the goal is to have the professionals build the knowledge and share it with the people outside. Now, sometimes the people outside say, wait a moment, we would like to say something. And the trick of a good professional society is to know when to listen, know when to understand, and when you can incorporate new ideas into the body of knowledge you're building. So, what do we do in organizing knowledge? First off, we decide what professional standing is. Who is a professional? Who has gone through the same kind of education that we have, or sometimes what's a new kind of education that's important to bring into your society. We organize knowledge through publications. We also do it through standard ways of doing things. We hold conferences, and we're very active in education. We have developed most of the curriculum for computer engineering, software engineering, security engineering, and computer science that are used globally. Indeed, those of you who studied these subjects will undoubtedly have been involved with classes and courses that were shaped either directly by your professor in school following those curriculum, or by the fact that those curriculum are so widely known that they influence quite naturally what goes on in technical schools. That picture, by the way, is a group of my students, and we're standing in front of a piece of hardware. Does anyone recognize it? Didn't think so. Google server number one. It's on display at the Smithsonian. Google server number one is interesting because not only the idea that creates the Google search engine, but that the two young men who created it didn't have any money, so they went and they begged equipment from their professors. They were at Stanford. Stanford is a very wealthy university, and professors apparently have used computers in the corner of their offices, and they were able to collect about 20 of them. They bought a cabinet for about $100, put that in, put it together, programmed it, and that became the start of what Google is. Standards are probably our most important and most visible activity, because everything that happens in the engineering world depends on people following a standard procedure, doing it the way others doing it. And one of the important things in building these standards is making sure you have the right expertise there to do it. The one that you all know, and that some of you are using right now because I see your computers are open and you're answering email and not listening to me, which is a good thing to do, is IEEE 802, Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi standard we started building in the 1980s because we knew it was going to be important to have a common standard, a common way of dealing with wireless networks. We got the people together who were interested. We had a lot of people who knew about the challenges we had with wired networks, how there were half dozen ways of hooking up modems, different settings for each kind of computer, and we agreed on a common way of doing it. And that common way makes it so that anyone can flip open their computer and wait a moment while it syncs, and you can start getting your email, or playing games, or looking at Facebook without any problems at all. We do this by assembling everyone who has a stake in it. We are viewed as a neutral party because we're not making money off of it. We have a process that gets a discussion going, that tries to get people to put all their interests on it, and then tries to build compromises between different groups. In the end, the standard is done by consensus. It's not quite everyone agrees, but everyone agrees not to object to it. And because we have these standards process, because we're neutral, we are protected from antitrust, from claiming that we have adjusted it for someone's point of view. We try to do it as neutrally and as generally as possible, so that even, as you can see, little kids with a cell phone can answer their emails. The biggest standard that we have, the biggest one that we promote, is that for software engineering. The IEEE owns the standard of what it means to be a software engineer and to practice software engineering. It's incorporated in a book, which we're engineers, so we just use the acronym, and we call it SWEBOK. It stands for Software Engineering Body of Knowledge. It's available on the web for free. If you go to SWEBOK.org, you will be able to see the entire standard of what it means to be a software engineer and download it. Now, there's a bunch of other material that goes with it. We charge it for it. But you'll be able to see the topics, the ideas, the outlines, and the bibliographies that say where this material is from. We started this process back in the 1970s and finished it for the first time in 1995. It became a standard, not only with us, but with the International Standards Organization in Geneva, ISO. And it has a number there. I'm very proud that under my presidency, if I did anything, and of course I didn't do a bit of work on this, SWEBOK was revised and released with the updated version that reflects the modern techniques of software engineering, including agile methods and lean methods, and the other things that are commonly used by software engineers globally. This process, software engineering is a very new form of engineering. And what I loved to do when I was president of the IEEE is tell my electrical engineering friends that it has nothing to do with electrical engineering. And they would look at me and they would say, "What do you mean it has nothing to do with electrical engineering? It runs on a computer, and computers are electronics, so it has something to do with electrical engineering." And I would say, "No, no, it has nothing at all." They would get very mad. But what happened was software engineering grew out of a process of trying to make high-quality engineering. And they didn't see how the tools of electrical engineering, of black boxing, of circuits, of other things, fit into their process. Eventually, we have incorporated some of them, but most of them came independently. What happened? Software engineering got its start at this meeting. This picture here is a conference that occurred in November 1968 in Garmisch, Germany. It was sponsored by NATO, and the question the conference tried to answer is, what does it take to get good software? At the same time, almost exactly at the same time, IBM, which had been giving software away for free, said, we're going to start asking you to pay for software. And with those two activities, we started a process of developing the ideas of what good and well-engineered software was. These are IEEE standards that we developed starting with that conference. It took almost 15 years to get the first ones done. And that first one, 829, said, this is how you test software and this is how you document it. The following year, we did requirement specifications, the taxonomy for software standards, how we were going to organize software engineering came out in 87. 88, 730, one of the most important standards that we have done for software engineering, said, how do you assure that you have high quality software? Measures of dependability came out that year, followed by configuration management, and the last one, which is really the basis for SWEBOC, the software lifecycle. All of these were done by our members, volunteers, working without pay. They were self-selected. They said, I would like to work on this, and they joined the committees. Some of them, such as the first one on the list, 829, took them about 6 years of work to do. Some of the others were done much more quickly. But it's not an easy process, and it devolves real dedication by the people involved. Once we have standards, we like to publish them, and this is my favorite part of the society because for 2 years I was the publisher. We put out a variety of publications that structure knowledge. There are basically two types. There are types that are academic, that are transactions and journals, that are very closely refereed and describe what are the newest ideas and how the work of one professor fits into the work of the entire field. The others, and these are three of them, are more like professional magazines. Their goal is to keep you abreast of what's going on, the new ideas, where things are going. The key aspect is we verify all of them. They're refereed by volunteers who dedicate their time and their effort to making sure that the articles are the best as possible. It keeps all of us up to date, but in particular, it keeps the professor up to date, because those are the people who are helping to teach the next generation, and they need to know what the field is. In computer science, however, and in software engineering and everything connected with it, the conferences have really been the place where the newest ideas have been discussed. And there are conferences like this one. Some of them are quite small, 40, 50 people. However, we have others that are close to 10,000. And then we have everything in between. This conference, I was president that year. This was in Mumbai. I was addressing it. And it brought together the three pictures I think are very nice, the three people there. The one on the far left is a young professor who is just starting his career, is about 6 years into it. The one on the far right is a friend of mine who teaches at the University of British Columbia and has been a professor for 25 or 30 years. And in the middle of it is the founder of Tata Consultancy. He is someone who works in business. He does not have an advanced degree, but he knows a great deal about software and its applications. And conferences bring together communities such as this. They give you contact outside of your own field. They teach you about others. They give you new knowledge of what other employers are doing. They build skills and knowledge. And in particular, one of the great things is they share the ideas that you can't publish, the things that come from talking to other people to see what best practices are, what little skills you need on the side to help make things work. They are, in some ways, the core of our society. We have about 250 of them that we operate, of which five last year all had the name International Cloud Computing Conference. The software workforce. We have been doing a great deal to support the development of that. And there are now three ways of getting into that. And this is what really sets us apart from traditional engineering. Many people are trained at universities, and they have a degree in software engineering or computer engineering or security engineering. And from that degree, they practice. However, in computing since day zero, many, many people have been trained by corporations. And you find this increasingly so in India, which is responsible for where corporations are responsible for training at least 20% of the high-end workforce. I'm an example of it, although it was in my father's hand where I learned it, but I learned it from corporate training materials. And indeed, you still see a very large fraction of people who go into computing and computer engineering without a formal training. But that leads to one more area, and that's the self-defined communities, largely centered around open source software. Software that's free, software that's not owned by a company, software that is being developed by a small group. This is WordPress, Linux is another. There are thousands of software systems that are now done by volunteers. WordPress, I have two special connections to this. One is I use it regularly. But second, one of my students married the head of it. And through her, through my student, into her husband, I've begun to see how this works closely. He got his start not because he was a computer person. In fact, he had no training at all. He volunteered to help figure out how a website worked. And then he got some skills, and he started tracking what was needed to make it work better. He learned some programming language. He worked with others on the project. And step by step, he gained skill, rose through the ranks, and is now the lead developer for it. That is increasingly defining a large part of our community. WordPress represents 23% of the sites on the World Wide Web globally, just as another big open source project, Linux, now represents close to 50% of the operating systems being used globally. More if you really start looking closely at cell phones. These are involved people who have come up in different ways, and they need help to be professionals, to advance themselves, and these are groups that we work with very closely. Our goal is to try and improve your skills, increase the trust among people, so that you know what someone else has, how they work, how they understand the problem. And ultimately, it's there to reduce risk, so that you've got a team that may be global, that may be spread across two or three or five countries, that has the same goals, the same kinds of knowledge, and the same practices. This is a group of people that I work with. This is a group of students from an organization I do work for about once every other year that's located in Ireland. They are a group of software engineers from around the world, and I'm trying to help them up to the next level. But what's fascinating is while there are always three or four people in the group who are actually from Ireland, the bulk of them are not. This is their common meeting place, and this is where they are trying to move themselves into the front edge of computing technology. So, what does it do for you? Why should Russia and Russian universities think about forming a chapter? Why should Russian businesses think of supporting local activities and local conferences? Well, I've got an interesting series of stats here, and it's called the G8 problem. The bulk of our members live in the industrialized countries, the G20 for sure, but I just have the numbers from the G8. I was sitting in an IEEE meeting and someone said, we're not going to be satisfied until we have members from all 210 countries of the world. And I sort of woke up. I had not been paying attention. I believe I was answering email at the time on my cell phone. And I said, that doesn't make a lot of sense. What we need to make sure is that our members are well distributed amongst the industrialized countries. And so I raised my hand and I made a comment to that effect. And one of the staff members ran off and found the population statistics and the numbers for us, not in the G20, but in the G8. And here we have some numbers that show how the world is changing. This is the G8, the countries in it, and the percent of population that they represent. The United States represents roughly 35% of it. Next column is the percent of members of the IEEE. And the United States, for example, is 48%. So that the United States is overrepresented in the IEEE by a factor of about 1.3, 1.4 almost. And you go down. Canada has 4% of the population and it has 4% of the members. So Canada, which seems to be a very well-balanced country, has the right number of people in the IEEE. Italy, I was surprised. I made a claim at dinner the other night that they were overrepresented. They are actually not, but they are heavily overrepresented among the leadership, which means that we have very good dinners, they choose lovely restaurants, and their taste in wine is exquisite. But then we get to Russia, bless its heart. 16% of the G8, 1%, less than 1%, 0.3% of the IEEE. What's being missed here is the opportunity to work with the rest of it, to work with the other organizations and find out what they're doing, to share information, to share knowledge, to understand what their processes are. We've been doing this with a number of different countries who have not historically had a lot of presence in the IEEE. In particular, in the last 3 years, I have been working with China, India, Japan. The current president this year has been working very closely to build with Korea. In those cases, we often work with a local partner, the Chinese Computing Federation, the Computing Society of India, the Information Processing Society of Japan, which gave me a brief opportunity to demonstrate to native Japanese speakers how bad my Japanese has become. And we have put together a number of programs to help them with local needs. I'm most active with the Chinese Computing Federation and their program. We have newsletters, we have Chinese language publications that are targeted for their membership that are based both on their work and on work from others that we translate. We have a membership activity where joining the Chinese Computing Federation will transfer over into an IEEE membership very quickly or something very close to it. And in fact, part of it is one of the things I do for this group is I have a monthly column where I try to put what China's doing in a global context. It's published in Mandarin, which means I have to have friends read it to tell me if it says what I think it said when I wrote it. But it has earned me a bunch of followers on Facebook who seem to like it, seem to want to be my friend, and seem to want to send me comments that I have to take a long time to translate. But we do the joint membership with India, we have new publications that we're working on with Japan, and we have started a joint membership program with Korea. All of these are to build a global foundation for work, a global foundation for technical knowledge, a global foundation for this field which we believe to be universal. Computers are supposedly the universal machine. And if it truly is universal, and if it truly does have benefits that can benefit all, we need a very broad group of people working on it, we need them to cooperate, and we need to understand what each other is thinking. And that is our goal. This is from my last visit to India. We had a hackathon where we had groups of students working on a problem, and it was like any other hackathon I've been to. But what I enjoyed seeing about them was sitting there, arguing away, trying to solve a problem, and then, because this is the way we work now, contacting their friends in the United States, in the United Kingdom, to see what ideas they might have that would help them produce a better project. So this is my talk.